Social psychology deals with behavior of individuals in a society as group members. Group morale is part of social psychology. Similarly, social norms, role and status are connected with social psychology. The meaning of group morale. By group morale, we mean the spirit of unity and organization of society. Two aspects of group morale may be visualized. One of them is mental, while the other one is social. The mental aspect indicates the mental attitude of different members of their group. The second aspect relates to the unity of the group. The group whose morale is of high order commands more unity among its members. The members of such a group constantly try to maintain its unity. The group with morale of a high order faces all adverse situations and maintains its unity against heavy odds. Due to this unity, each member takes interest in others. Determinants of morale. For building up group morale, there should be a coordination in some feelings of its members. For example, fulfillment of a common need is necessary for a person's happiness. Consequently, when a person realizes that he will be able to fulfill his need with the help of the group, he will then be always helpful in the building up of group morale of a high order. Positive goal. There should be a positive goal before the members of the group for maintaining the morale. In the absence of this positive goal, the feeling of unity and organization is difficult to last long. When there is a positive goal before the members, all the members get determined to achieve it. In the absence of positive goal, the morale becomes weak. If their morale is based on fear, then it collapses early and the enemy becomes victorious. Consciousness of achieving the goal. When a manager of a factory informs his workers about their achievement, the workers put in more labor and produce more. If the manager is silent and does not encourage his workers, the workers also work with indifference. This principle applies to members of any group. When the group leader informs the members of their success, their morale goes up and they are always willing to follow the suggestions of the leaders. Let us see the satisfaction of social drives. The desire to satisfy some social drives is present in everyone. For example, all persons desire honor, recognition and opportunities of self-expression because these satisfy their social drives. The members of their group who continue to get such opportunities feel a sense of fulfillment and honor. They think that their group is of a superior order and their fulfillment and honor depends on its safety and security. This view helps in the creation of high morale. Let us see tolerance and freedom. It is necessary for the leader of the group to be tolerant and to give due attention to the views of every member. When the leader starts criticizing the members on slightest pretext, the members get discouraged and lose courage and start doubting the policy, program and the goal. This feeling among the members proves detrimental in the building up of high group morale. Let us study about the equality of profit and sacrifice. For group morale of a high order, it is necessary for different individuals that they feel that like the others, they too will be benefited. They should also have the satisfaction of getting proper reward for their sacrifice. During the Second World War, control over the distribution of various articles was introduced in India. It was expected of this control that it would benefit the common man, but unfortunately, their expectations were not fulfilled. The reason was that behind the curtain of control, black marketing and other evils started plaguing the society. In order to end this depressing situation and to raise the morale of the masses, the government of independent India assured the people that every citizen of the country was equal and would share benefits, and each would receive proper reward for his labor and sacrifice. Let us study about the aimed level and obtained level. In the building up of group morale, aimed level and obtained level have great importance. It is of course necessary that for the fulfillment of that positive goal, smaller plans or schemes be formulated first. It is also necessary that the members realize that along with the planning, they are getting the results too. This knowledge will create in members confidence towards their leaders, and this confidence or faith will be helpful in the building up of high group morale. Leader is also important. Let us study about the importance of leader and leadership. The place of the leader is of supreme importance in a group, society or community. An able leader may help keep the morale of his group high in any adverse situation. Mahatma Gandhi was such a great leader who in his lifetime succeeded in creating morale of the highest and noblest order amongst Indians. Time is important in doing any type of our activities. Let us study about the understanding time correctly. For building up a high order of group morale, it is necessary for the members of the group to know what had happened in the past and what future possibilities are. When he sees some favorable future possibilities, he gets on with the job with double determination and enthusiasm. Let us study about the feeling of solidarity. Feeling of solidarity is very helpful in building up of high group morale. We know that when we find ourselves alone in any adverse situation, we lose our patience, but when we realize that we are not alone and there are others solidly behind us, we develop patience and get prepared to face the situation boldly. Let us study about the feeling of identification. High morale becomes a distinct possibility when an individual identifies his interest with group interest. He does not even see any difference in his own interests and those of the group. Then he is ready to make any sacrifice. When all the members develop this feeling, then morale reaches the peak of its development. Morale is studied by different methods, the first method being the rating of attitude. Some questionnaires relating to group and its leader are so prepared that an idea may be had about the attitude of the leader and the members. A copy of the questionnaire is given to each member for filling in. For example, in case of a questionnaire relating to education, the questions will relate to curriculum, organization of school, method of teaching, teachers, library and other factors related to educational activities. The other method of studying the group morale is by survey of general employee opinion. In this context, a questionnaire is given to employees and they are asked to fill it in. The questions are so prepared that complete knowledge about the job and working conditions is gained through replies. The employee is not supposed to write his name. Each employee therefore replies frankly. One has to be very careful in preparing such questionnaires. The next method is by exit interview. The attitude of members towards their leader may be found out through this method. The basis of this method is the view that as long as an employee is in service, he is afraid of expressing his views frankly for fear of losing the job or getting punishment if his views are found unfavorable. This method may be applied to any group, institution, political party, educational institution or commercial organization for knowing the morale of the people related to the same. The next method is called the sociometric method. Morino introduced this method first of all, and therefore it is named after him. It is a simple method and no difficulty is faced in its implementation. The attitude of the persons related to any commercial, industrial organization, educational institution or political party towards its officers and employers may be known through this method. Let us see the summary of what we have studied so far. When there is group morale, there is feeling of organization and unity. When the morale is high, there is interest in each other, similarity in objectives and obedience to observing rules. There is no place for fear and hatred among members. Let us study about the social norms, role and status, which is a part of social psychology. Each society has its separate norms on the basis of which the prosperity or otherwise of a behavior is evaluated. Social norms are based on the social behavior which accord with the main objectives of the society. The assumption of the social role is undertaken by the society for the individual. Society expects from every individual a particular kind of behavior. Often in a society, people talk of status of someone or the other because everyone has a status of his own. In a society, teacher, doctor, banker enjoys a status and they are expected to behave according to their respective status or any position. In the absence of social norms, the existence or the stability of a society is endangered. Consequently, these have an important place in a society. Under social norms come customs, traditions, rules, fashions and popular sayings and other types of social controls. Social norms are based on those social behaviors which accord with the main objectives of the society. Social norms may be regarded as generalizations. Value and judgments get involved in them. Language has a special place in the creation of a social norm. It is through language that a norm passes from one generation to the other. Under the purview of social norms come some rules, ideal conducts, values, customs, traditions and rights. Great persons too set certain norms. For example, Mahatma Gandhi during the struggle for independence of India created some social norms like Ahimsa and Satyagraha on the basis of Indian ideals and values. These norms greatly benefited the nation and the people. Let us study about the assumption of social role. Often it is said that a man thinks it proper to behave in the manner the society expects of him, but sometimes the individual himself assumes the social role and tries to develop himself accordingly. In this way, whatever a man gets accustomed to in the society becomes his assumption of the social role. We may also say that an individual's assumption of the social role is according to or is favorable to his social expectations. In this context of favorability, he develops such a pattern of his social behavior as appears to him most suitable in the situation before him. Let us study about the mutual assumption of the role. For the stability of a society, it is necessary that the assumption of role of the members is mutual. In the absence of this mutual factor, the society gets disrupted. Therefore, in every society, the assumption of role is mutual. We observe that assumption of role between husband and wife, teacher and taught, master and servant, officer and subordinates, mother, father and son, public and the government, buyer and seller is mutual. It is expected of husband and wife to mutually discharge their assumed roles. It is expected of the teacher and the taught that they do their duty according to their assumed roles. Let us study about the social status. In the society, teacher, doctor, banker, high officer and priest enjoy a status and they are expected to behave according to their respective status or position. A man is reminded of his status during marriage or any other social or religious ceremony. Some persons due to their social status have to entertain their guests with wine and meat during marriage. Some, in order to maintain their social status, have to arrange for the dance of eunuchs, buns, clowns, jesters or dancing girls. A man's position in his society is known as his social status or position. everyone enjoys some place in his society. This place signifies his status in the society, and due to this position, he is expected to show some particular behavior on some particular occasion. According to this expectation, as has been said earlier, members of some caste show particular behavior. Now, let us study about the determination of social status. The status or the position of a man in the society is determined on the basis of his office, place, age, sex, occupation, character, family, and membership of any particular institution. The social status of the rich and the poor varies. Often it is noticed that a rich man has a higher status in the society, but it is also found that a man of character enjoys still higher social status than many corrupt rich persons. Therefore, character is a very powerful factor in determining one's social status. In each society, there is a definite standard for judging social status. This standard is not based on a scientific basis. The basis is psychological. On this psychological basis, the society has upper, middle, lower middle, and lower class people in a hierarchical order. The people falling into these different categories try to show behavior accordingly. The position of an individual in a society is determined on the basis of age and sex. We find that in a society, greater respect is accorded to elderly persons and to women. In a social function, they enjoy the front place. Position also depends on status of birth. A king's son, even if he is not a king, enjoys a very high social status. A man may achieve higher social status to persons engaged in different trades according to the importance of their trades. The man is praised for the ethics of his trade and condemned for his bad or antisocial business. Once being born in a high family also commands a higher social status. Membership of an honored society also raises the social status of a person. For example, membership of institutions like Royal Society, Servants of India Society, French Academy, etc., raises the social status of members, because the membership of such institutions means that the individual concerned has made some noteworthy contribution in a particular field. To sum up what we have studied so far in this lesson is dealt with social norms, role and status. Working rules, ideals of conduct and traditions come within the purview of social norms. Society determines an individual's assumption of role. Assumptions of role of different members are interrelated. Every individual has a social status. Everyone tries to act or behave according to it. Respect for an individual indicates his status in the society, office, place, order, age, sex, occupation, family, membership of a particular society determines social status of the person concerned.